Gildan Media, a division of Recorded Books, presents Computational Thinking by Peter J. Denning and Matti Tedre. Narrated by Stephen J. Cohen. Preface. A computer revolution is in full swing. The invasion of computing into every part of our lives has brought enormous benefits, including email, internet, World Wide Web, Amazon's e-commerce, Khan Academy, Uber's taxi hailing, Google's maps, trip navigators, smartphones, real-time translators, and apps by the millions. At the same time, it has also brought enormous concerns, including possible loss of jobs to automation, mass surveillance, collapse of critical infrastructure, cyber war, mass sales of personal data, invasions of advertising, loss of privacy, polarization of politics, loss of civility and respectful listening, and exacerbated income inequality. A lot of people are having trouble coming to grips with all this. Can they reap the benefits without the downside costs? Can they lead a meaningful life if computerization suddenly threatens to obsolete a lifetime of learning? What should their children learn about computing to enable them to move and prosper in the new world? Computational thinking is a new term that has recently entered public discourse as people struggle with these questions. It holds the hope that we can think clearly about the powers and dangers of mass computing, and that we can learn to design computers, software, and networks to maximize the benefits and minimize the risks. Parents are already amazed at how facile their children seem to be in the digital world. Is computational thinking the recipe for giving our children a proper education in this world? We designed this book to be an edifying conversation to help you understand what computational thinking is, so that you will be in a better position to answer these questions for yourself. The first thing to understand is that a substantial part of daily discourse is shaped by the wide adoption of computers. This is nothing new. Our ancestors' ways of thinking about the world were shaped by the technologies of previous revolutions. In the Industrial Age, for example, people regularly used expressions like, "He blew a gasket," "I'm humming on all pistons," "It's a high-pressure environment," and "I had to blow off steam." Today, we hear expressions like, "My DNA programs me to do it this way." Our laws are algorithms for running our society. "My brain is hardware and my mind software." And, "My brain crashed. I need to reboot." Just as in the Industrial Age, the new idioms of the computer age reveal more about our popular culture than they do about the technology. Like the Greek god Janus, computational thinking has two faces, one that looks behind and explains all that has happened, and one that looks ahead to what can be designed. We invoke both faces when we want to get computers to do jobs for us. On the back-facing side, we need to understand the mechanics of how computers work, how they are controlled by algorithms, how we can express algorithms in a programming language, and how we can combine many software modules into working systems. On the forward-facing side, we need sensibilities to understand the context in which users of our software are working. We want our software to be valuable to them and not to cause harm to them or their environment. Thus, computational thinking guides us to understand the technology available to us and to design software to do a job or solve a problem. Computational thinking is not only something programmers must know, but it is also a thinking tool for understanding our technology-infused social world. It increases our awareness of how our everyday digital tools work, grounds our cyber ethics, and improves our resilience against various threats, such as algorithm-driven attempts to guide our behavior, personally tailored fake news, viral powers of social media, and massive data-intensive analysis of our movements. What is more, computational thinking has irrevocably changed the tools, methods, and epistemology of science. Learning CT has many benefits beyond programming. If you try to understand what computational thinking is from media accounts, you will hear a story of problem-solving with algorithms, along with the ability to think at the many levels of abstraction needed to solve problems. The story is flavored with images of joyous children having fun programming and playing games in which they simulate algorithms. Indeed, our teachers have learned much about computational thinking from teaching computing to children, and they have developed superb ways of teaching fundamental computing insights to newcomers. In this book, we call this CT for Beginners. But the K-12 education insights and debates barely scratch the surface of computational thinking. At the more advanced levels, computational thinking concerns the design of hardware, networks, storage systems, operating systems, and the cloud. Its historical predecessors have organized human teams to do large computations, organized production lines in manufacturing, guided lawmakers, and specify the rules of bureaucracies. It has developed styles attuned to major areas where computing plays a critical role, such as artificial intelligence, large data analytics, software engineering, and computational science. We will show you all this by examining the kinds of computational thinking needed to deal with these different dimensions of computing. A much more advanced kind of computational thinking is needed to deal with these areas. We call it CT for professionals. Computational thinking is sometimes portrayed as a universal approach to problem solving. Take a few programming courses, the story in the popular media goes, and you will be able to solve problems in any field. Would that this were true? Your ability to solve a problem for someone depends on your understanding of their context in which the problem exists. For instance, you cannot build simulations of aircraft in flight without understanding fluid dynamics. You cannot program searches through genome databases without understanding the biology of the genome and the methods of collecting the data. Computational thinking is powerful, but not universal. Computational thinking illuminates a fundamental difference in the ways that humans and machines process information. Machines can process information at billions or trillions of calculations per second, whereas humans do well at one calculation per second. Machines process with no understanding of the data they are processing, whereas humans do and can correct errors on the fly. Machines can transform a mistake into an algorithm, into a costly disaster, before any human has a chance to react. Thinkers in the philosophy of mind, neuropsychology, cognitive science, and artificial intelligence have studied these differences and shown us how fundamentally dissimilar they are. Although some human tasks, like searching and sorting, can be eased by applying algorithms to them, most computational thinking in the big picture is concerned with machine computation. Think for a moment about the speed issue. A typical computer can, in 1 second, perform a billion calculations and draw a complex image on the screen. A human would need 100 years to carry out the same steps at human speed. Humans obviously draw pictures much faster than that, but machine designers have yet to imitate that human capacity. If humans had no help from computers, we would have no real-time graphics. Nearly everything we see software doing is made possible by the incredible speeds of computers. These machines, not humans executing algorithms on their own, are the reason for the computer revolution. Computing machines do the humanly impossible. While this may send a thrill up your neck, it ought also to send a shiver down your spine. Modern aircraft are controlled by networks of computers performing billions of calculations per second. A mistake in an algorithm can cause the control system to send the aircraft into a death spiral long before the human pilot can react. Early Apollo missions and more recent Mars missions were aborted and lost due to errors in their software. Mistakes in algorithms can be deadly and costly. How can we know that the algorithms running critical systems can be trusted to work properly, bringing benefits and low risk of harm? We need clear thinking to help us find our way through this maze of complexity. This requires an advanced form of CT that is not learned from children's simulation games. CT for professionals is deadly serious. Our account of CT in this book encompasses all the flavors of CT from beginners to professionals and in major subfields such as software engineering and computational science. We aim to describe CT in all its richness, breadth, and depth. We want to celebrate the work of expert professionals who take on the hard challenges of getting complex systems to perform reliably and safely, and the kinds of thinking they bring that enables them to have achieved such a good track record. We also want to celebrate the work of expert educators who are working to ease the first steps into computational thinking in K-12 schools and lay the foundation to provide everyone the means for coping in the digital world. Those two, basic CT for beginners and advanced CT for professionals, work together to produce a rich tapestry of computational thought. Peter J. Denning, Salinas, California, August 2018. Matti Tedre, Joensuu, Finland, August 2018. 1. What is computational thinking? An algorithm is a set of rules for getting a specific output from a specific input. Each step must be so precisely defined that it can be translated into computer language and executed by machine. Donald Knuth, 1977. What is a computer? Most people will answer it is an electronic black box that does amazing things by collecting, storing, retrieving, and transforming data. Almost all our devices and gadgets are computers. Phones, tablets, desktops, web pages, watches, navigators, thermometers, medical devices, clocks, televisions, DVD players, Wi-Fi networks. Our services are software. Bookstores, retail stores, banks, transportation, Uber, hotel reservations, Airbnb, filmmaking, entertainment, Dropbox, online courses, Google searches, and almost all run by unseen computers across an unseen worldwide network called the cloud. Computers have brought enormous benefits: new jobs, access to information, economic development, national defense, improvements in health, and much more. They have brought, as well, worrying concerns: job losses, globalization, privacy, surveillance, and more. It looks like everything that can be digitized is being digitized, and computers are everywhere, storing and transforming that information. A computer revolution is truly upon us. How shall we think about all this? What do we need to understand about computers? What must we do to put a computer to work for us? How do computers shape the way we see the world? What new do we see? What is the role of programming? What are computers not good for? The power and value of computation. Computational thinking, here abbreviated CT, offers some answers to these questions. Much of CT is specifically oriented on figuring out how to get a computer to do a job for us, how to control a complex electronic device to do a job reliably without causing damage or harm. Algorithms are the procedures that specify how the computer should do a job. Although humans can carry out algorithms, they cannot do so nearly as fast as a machine. Modern computers can do a trillion steps in the time it takes a human to do one step. The magic is nothing more than a machine executing large numbers of very simple computations, very fast. Programs are the bridge. Algorithms encoded in special-purpose languages that translate to machine instructions that control a computer. But CT reaches further than automation. Information and computational processes have become a way of understanding natural and social phenomena. Much of CT today is oriented toward learning how the world works. A growing number of biologists, physicists, chemists, and other scientists are looking at their subject matter through a computational lens. Professionals in the arts, humanities, and social sciences are joining in. Computer simulation enables previously impossible virtual experiments. The information interpretation of the world offers conceptual and empirical tools that no other approach does. CT also advises us about jobs that computers cannot do in any reasonable amount of time, or at all. Some jobs are impossible for computers. Many social, political, and economic problems are beyond the pale of computers. By understanding the limits of computing, we can avoid the trap of looking to computing technology to solve such problems. Obviously, designing a program or a machine to do so much in such a short time is a daunting design task that demands its own way of thinking if we are to have any confidence that the machine does the job without error. Indeed, understanding users and designing systems specifically for them turns out to be one of the great challenges of modern computing. Design is one of the central concerns of CT. Defining computational thinking. Computational thinking has become a buzzword with a multitude of definitions. We have distilled the spirit of the multitude into this definition used throughout this book. Computational thinking is the mental skills and practices for designing computations that get computers to do jobs for us and explaining and interpreting the world as a complex of information processes. The design aspect reflects the engineering tradition of computing in which people build methods and machines to help other people. The explanation aspect reflects the science tradition of computing in which people seek to understand how computation works and how it shows up in the world. Design features immersion in the community being helped. Explanation features being a dispassionate external observer. In principle, it is possible to design computations without explaining them, or explain computations without designing them. In practice, these two aspects go hand in hand. Computations are a complex series of numerical calculations and symbol manipulations. Examples of numerical calculations are the basic arithmetic operations, add, subtract, multiply, divide, and the basic trigonometric functions, sine, cosine, and tangent. Examples of symbolic manipulations are a logical comparison of numbers or symbols, decisions of what instructions to do next, or substitutions of one string of letters and numbers for another. Amazing computations can be carried out when trillions of such simple operations are arranged in the proper order. For example, forecasting tomorrow's weather, deciding where to drill for oil, designing the wings of an aircraft with enough lift to fly, finding which physical places are most likely to be visited by a person, calling for a taxi, or figuring out which two people would make a great couple. Computers are agents that carry out the operations of a computation. They follow programs of instructions for doing arithmetic and logic operations. Computers can be humans or machines. Humans can follow programs, but are nowhere near as fast or as error-free as machines. Machines can perform computational feats well beyond human capabilities. We use the word job to refer to any task that someone considers valuable. Today, many people look to computers, actually computations performed by computers, to get jobs done. They seek automation of jobs that could not be done without the aid of a machine. Computers are now getting good enough at some routine jobs so that loss of employment to automation has become an important social concern. We do not equate doing a job with automation. Well-defined routine jobs can be automated, but ill-defined jobs, such as meeting a concern, cannot. CT can help with jobs that cannot be automated. In the design chapter, we will discuss the kind of CT that does this. There is clearly a special thinking skill required to successfully design programs and machines capable of enormous computations and to understand natural information processes through computation. This skill, computational thinking, or CT, is not a set of concepts for programming. Instead, CT comprises ways of thinking and practicing that are sharpened and honed through practice. CT is a very rich skill set. At the end of this chapter, we outline the 6 dimensions of computational thinking that you will encounter in this book: machines, methods, computing education, software engineering, design, and computational science. Wishful thinking. In our enthusiasm for computational thinking, we need to be careful to avoid wishful thinking. Perhaps the first and most common wish is that we can get computers to do any job we can conceive of. This wish cannot be realized because there are many jobs that are impossible for computers. For example, there is no algorithm that will inspect another algorithm and tell us whether it terminates or loops forever. Every programming student longs for such an algorithm to help with debugging. It was logically impossible in 1936 when Alan Turing proved it so, and it is still impossible today. Even if we stick to logically possible jobs, there are many that cannot be done in a reasonable time. They are intractable. One famous example is the traveling salesman problem, which is to find the shortest tour on a map of a country that visits each city just once. An algorithm to compute this would be of great value in the package delivery industry. The simplest way to find the shortest tour is to enumerate all possible tours and select the shortest. For a small set of 100 cities, this would take 10 to the 130th power years on the world's fastest supercomputer. For comparison, the age of the universe is on the order of 10 to the power of 10 years. Even the simplest way can be impossible. Algorithms analysts have identified thousands of common problems that are intractable in this way. The picture gets even more confusing because in most cases there are fast algorithms to find an approximate answer. They are called heuristics. Take, for example, the problem of finding the shortest tour connecting all 24,978 cities in Sweden. The enumeration algorithm for the traveling salesman problem would take on the order of 10 to the 100,000th power years. But in 2004, a team at the University of Waterloo, using heuristics for optimization, found a shortest tour and proved it to be correct. Their solution used 85 years of processing time spread over a cluster of machines that took several months to complete the job. Computational thinkers need to develop enough experience and skill to know when jobs are impossible or intractable and look for good heuristics to solve them. A second example of wishful thinking is to believe that learning how to program in a computer science course or a coding intensive workshop will enable you to solve problems in any field that uses computation. No, you will need to learn something about the other field too. For example, even if you have studied search algorithms in a programming course, you are not likely to be able to be useful to a genomics project until you have learned genome biology and the significance of biological data. A third example of wishful thinking is to believe that computers are not essential to CT, that we can think about how to solve problems with algorithms and not be concerned with the computers that run the algorithms. But this is not so. When a computer does not have sufficient memory to hold all your data, you will seek ways to define your problem into subsets that will fit. When a single processor does not have sufficient processing power, you will seek a computer with multiple parallel processors and algorithms that divide the computation among them. When the computer is too slow, you will look inside to find a bottleneck component and either upgrade it or find a new algorithm that does not use that component. Even if your computer has sufficient memory, adequate processing power, and no bottlenecks, other aspects can limit your problem-solving progress, notably the speed of the internal clock, which paces the machine to perform computational steps in an orderly and predictable way. But some new machines, notably quantum computers and neural nets, have no clocks. How shall we think about programming then? A fourth example of wishful thinking is to believe the computer is smart. If you are imprecise in translating human steps into program steps, your computation will contain errors that could cause disasters. Computers are incredibly dumb. They perform mindless mechanical steps extremely fast, but they have no understanding of what the steps mean. The only errors they can correct are the ones you anticipate and provide with corrective algorithms. You are the source of the intelligence. The computer amplifies your intelligence but has none of its own. We advise you to approach CT with humility. It is a learned skill. Our brains do not naturally think computationally. Keep your perspective on the capabilities of computers and algorithms to do jobs on the need to learn something about the application domain you want to design for, on the dependency of computation on computers, and the abject lack of intelligence in the machine. Emergence of CT over millennia. It might seem that CT is a product of the electronic computer age that began in the 1940s. Well, not really. Before the modern computer age, there was a profession of mathematically trained experts who performed complex calculations as teams. They were called computers. They were by no means the first. The term computer, meaning one who computes, dates back to the early 1600s. The first electronic computing machines were called automatic computers to distinguish them from the human variety. Human computers, and even more so, the leaders of human computing teams, obviously engaged in computational thinking. So, many aspects of CT existed before electronic computers, well before. Primitive forms of CT as methods of calculation were recorded from around 1800 to 1600 BCE among the Babylonians, who wrote down general procedures for solving mathematical problems. Their rule-following procedures have features that we, from today's perspective, would label as forms of CT. Similarly, the Egyptian engineers who built the pyramids beginning around 2700 BCE obviously knew a lot about geometry and were able to calculate the dimensions and angles of stones for each part of the pyramid and of the leverage of ropes, pulleys, and rollers to move the stones into position. Computing is an ancient human practice. Over the ages, since ancient times, Mathematicians sought to spell out procedures for ever more advanced calculations, moving beyond calculating merchant transactions and the geometry of structures to trigonometry, astronomic predictions, celestial navigation, solving algebraic equations, and eventually computing with the calculus of Newton and Leibniz. By formalizing computing procedures, mathematicians made their expertise available to non-experts who simply had to follow directions of carrying out simple arithmetic operations in the proper order. A special class of those directions is today called an algorithm, a key concept in modern computing. The term algorithm comes to us from the Persian mathematician Muhammad ibn Musa al-Khwarizmi, who around 800 CE discussed how to formulate mathematical procedures and gave examples such as finding the greatest common divisor of a set of numbers. We humans have a penchant for automating routine procedures. So it has been for computational procedures. Inventors sought machines that would automate computation for the purposes of greater speed and fewer errors. Building machines to carry out these procedures turned out to be much harder than specifying the procedures. Pascal designed and built an arithmetic machine in the 1600s that was able to add and subtract. It could multiply only in the hands of a human operator who understood repeated addition. It could not do division. Napier invented the logarithm, which became the principle of the slide rule, an aid for calculation that continued well into the second half of the 1900s. It could not add or subtract. In 1819, Babbage designed a machine of gears, shafts, and wheels that could calculate tables of arithmetic numbers, such as logarithms. In the 1890 U.S. Census, Hollerith's punched card machines tabulated large amounts of data, and after its founding in 1924, IBM became wealthy from selling tabulating machines. In the 1920s, engineers designed analog computers to calculate continuous functions by simulating them with circuits and gears. Designers of mechanical, analog, and digital computers were obviously computational thinkers, but even the analog computer idea is ancient, dating back to the Greek orrery, a mechanical device used to calculate planetary positions in 100 BCE. Computing throughout the ages required computational thinking to design computational procedures and machines to automate them. The long quest for computing machines was driven not only by the need to speed up computation, but to eliminate human errors, which were common when easily bored or distracted humans performed many repetitive calculations. The designers believed automated machines would overcome the sources of error in calculations. Today we know better. While machines have eliminated some kinds of error, a whole horizon of new errors has appeared. Computing machines have become so complex that we do not know how much trust we can place on them. Seeds of computational thinking advanced in sophistication over those many centuries. But only when the electronic computer became an industry in the 1950s did computer designers and programmers find an impetus to develop CT as a professional concern. These professionals gravitated to software because they could easily alter a machine's function by reprogramming the software. The emerging computing industry sought programmers and engineers schooled in computational thinking and practice. Educators inquired into how to teach them. The computer science, CS, field that emerged by 1960 inherited the responsibility for defining and teaching CT. Throughout this book, we present many examples from the history of computing to illustrate the needs to which CT responded, the new possibilities for actions CT enabled, and the dramatic mind shifts CT caused in how we see automation, science, and the world. Although CT as a way of thinking has existed for thousands of years, the term computational thinking is relatively new. The first occurrence we are aware of is from 1980. Emergence of Education Movement for CT in K-12 Schools. The first computer science CS department was founded at Purdue in 1962. Academic computer science matured along a bumpy and challenging path. Many universities were initially skeptical whether the new field was really new or scholarly enough. It looked rather like a branch of electrical engineering or applied mathematics. Many computer science departments were formed only after pitched political battles in their universities. Despite the political difficulties, the growth was steady. By 1980, there were about 120 CS departments in the U.S. alone. Today, all major and many smaller universities have one. During the first 40 years, most of the concerns of practitioners in computing were focused on getting the technology to work. Everything we today consider a core technology had to be invented, designed, tested, and retested. Take, for example, programming languages, operating systems, networks, graphics, databases, robotics, and artificial intelligence. One of the central elements of CT, designing reliable computing technologies, became a standard during those times. In the 1980s, computing experienced a dramatic opening as scientists in all fields brought computation and computational thinking into mainstream science. At first, they used computation to simulate existing theoretical models or numerically tabulate and analyze data from experiments. But they soon discovered that thinking in terms of computation opened a door to a whole new way of organizing scientific investigation. CT led to Nobel Prizes for discoveries that had previously eluded scientists. Many declared computation a third pillar of science, alongside theory and experiment. CT was extended to designing computations throughout science, especially in response to grand challenge questions posed by leaders in the different fields. Every field of science eventually declared it had a computational branch, such as computational physics, bioinformatics, computational biology, digital humanities, or computational sociology. Computer scientists had mixed reactions to these developments. Remembering their battle scars from forming departments, some were quite sensitive to the public image of computer science and wanted to control it. Some regarded the computational science movement as a means to hijack computer science by scientists who had previously expressed skepticism about computer science. As a result, computer scientists had a strong motivation to help the public understand the technology and theory of computing. Computer science educators worked with K-12 educators to define computer literacy courses, but these were not very popular. Around the year 2000, some educators proposed a more sophisticated approach they called fluency with information technology. High school teachers adopted a popular textbook in that area. Even with the success of the fluency approach, few high schools adopted a computer course. Computer science educators continued to seek ways to penetrate K-12 school systems and expose every student to computing. A turning point came in 2006 when Jeanette Wing, then starting as an assistant director at the U.S. National Science Foundation, NSF, reformulated the quest from fluency to computational thinking. She proposed that CT was a style of thinking that everyone needed to learn in the computing age. At the NSF, she mobilized significant resources to train teachers, upgrade the advanced placement test, design new CS principles, first courses for colleges, define CT for the K-12 education sector, and issue curriculum recommendations for K-12 schools. This CS for All movement has achieved much greater penetration of computing into K-12 schools than any of its predecessors. The definitions of CT, that have emerged from the post-2006 CT movement have moved conspicuously into the public view, but many public definitions, especially as interpreted to us by policymakers, are quite narrow compared to the notions of CT developed over the earlier centuries of.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.